Terlalu besar, terlalu tinggi. Tapi enggak, oh, enggak ini. Ini, yang ini, ini.
Satu.
Dua, tuh. Empat-empatnya. Nah, yang ini begini. Kalau audio dari laptop, kalau foto yang kalau suara dari luar loh ya. Kalau suara dari dalam enggak usah, enggak apa-apa.
Video laptop itu apa?
Video itu. Ya misalkan ada video ini nanti yang ini. Yang ini masternya yang master itu yang itu. Hari persiapan PA juga itu.
Aku ini tanggung yang diri.
Enggak, yang itu, yang ini enggak apa-apa, yang ini direkat aja. Anunya tetap dari sini hernya.
Cepetan sih.
Lah iya, rekod kan direkod langsung kan enggak masalah dong. Sebenarnya direkod langsung yang di mana? Oh gitu, sama aja sih sebenarnya. Ya udah langsung direkod aja enggak apa-apa kalau ini.
Pisir mas dulu aja ya, pisir dulu.
Selamat datang di program studi pendidikan dokter spesialis radiologi FKUB RSSA. Lahir di kota Malang, kota bunga tempat kami bertumbuh dan belajar menjadi seorang radiolog yang unggul dan berkompeten. Perjalanan kami dimulai pada tahun 2000. Kami terus berkembang dan menghasilkan lulusan yang unggul dan bermutu yang telah tersebar di seluruh penjuru negeri.
PSPDS Radiologi FKUB memiliki visi menjadi institusi pendidikan dokter spesialis radiologi pelopor dan pembaharu dengan reputasi internasional untuk menghasilkan lulusan unggul di bidang deteksi dini penyakit dan komplikasinya.
PSPDS Radiologi FKUB menjunjung tinggi norma budaya lokal, namun berorientasi maju untuk terus mendunia. Kami berkomitmen menjadi pioner tridharma perguruan tinggi berstandar internasional dengan keunggulan dalam bidang deteksi dini penyakit dan komplikasinya yang tercermin dalam setiap kegiatan kami. Proses pendidikan PSPDS Radiologi FKUB ditunjang dengan berbagai fasilitas yang lengkap dan nyaman, tata kelola program studi yang unggul dan berkelanjutan, serta kurikulum yang terintegrasi dan berstandar internasional. Dan inilah persembahan kami, PSPDS Radiologi FKUB untuk kemajuan pendidikan, penelitian, dan pengabdian masyarakat di Indonesia.
Mari bergabung bersama kami di PSPDS Radiologi FKUB.
Toe to toe, I should be scared, honey, maybe so. But don't know what you've been told.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have your attention, please. Our event will start shortly, so please find yourself a seat to settle down. We seek your cooperation to fill in the empty chairs in the front row first. Move forward to the empty chair. Before we begin, I would like to announce some housekeeping notes. First, please switch your mobile phone to silent mode in order to avoid any interruption, especially during presentation and discussion. Secondly, we do hope that all participants could stay in this room until the end of today's agenda. Thank you, and we will begin at the event for today. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah rabbil alamin, assalatu wassalamu ala asrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in amma ba'du. Before we start, I would like to welcome our honorable and distinguished guest, the Dean of Faculty of Medicine Universitas Brawijaya, Dr. Dr. Wisnu Barlianto, MSI Med, Pediatric Specialist Consultant, the Head of Radiology Specialist Education Program in Faculty of Medicine Universitas Brawijaya, Dr. Indra Suti Normahayu, Radiology Specialist Consultant. Our honorable speakers today, Professor James F. Griffith, Radiology Professor at Chinese University of Hong Kong. Welcome, Professor. And Professor Kwek Xiao Tian, Radiology Professor at the National University of Singapore. Welcome, Professor. We are so pleased to have you here. And then Dr. Paulus Raharjo, Radiology Specialist Consultant, Head of Indonesian Musculoskeletal Radiology Society. Head of Medical Radiology Staff and Radiology Department, Saiful Anwar General Hospital, Dr. Irma Darina Fiti, Radiology Specialist Consultant. Head of Radiology Installation of Saiful Anwar General Hospital, Dr. Agung Setiawan, Radiology Specialist Consultant, and other supervisor Radiology Department of Faculty of Medicine Universitas Brawijaya, and my fellow radiology resident of Faculty of Medicine Universitas Brawijaya, and of course of our welcome and gratitude to all participants of this event who attended here or with us by live streaming. My name is Ginanda, and today I will be your master of ceremony and be with you throughout this event. Let me begin this today event with basmalah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. We will now invite the Dean of Faculty of Medicine Universitas Brawijaya, Dr. Dr. Wisnu Barlianto, MSI Med, Pediatric Specialist Consultant, to give an opening speech. To Dr. Wisnu, the time is yours.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, our honorable speaker today, Professor James F. Griffith, Radiology Professor at Chinese University of Hong Kong, Professor Kwek Swee Tian, Radiology Professor at the National University of Singapore, and the Honorable Head of Radiology Special Education, Dr. Indra Suti Normahayu, Dr. Paulus Raharjo from Faculty of Medicine from Erlangga, Prof. Yuyun Yuniwati, and Dr. Irma, Head of Department of Radiology, and all of staff Radiology Department. First of all, we would like to thank Prof. Griffith and Prof. Quick for the opportunity to be willing to attend to give a guest lecture at the upcoming event of musculoskeletal radiology, which will be held this week. Thank you for your coming and your lecture in this afternoon. Yeah. I hope this lecture will be give knowledge for my student, our student. And I hope this lecture will be the continue event, and we have maybe from the other university. Yeah. Thank you for all the committee for this lecture. Finally, for our student, congratulations on attending today's great lecture. I hope it will be useful for you. And thank you so much for the welcome to Malang. I hope you enjoy it. And I'm sorry if there is mistaken from us. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Doctor. Before we start our today's event, it would be better if we start with prayer. The prayers detailed with presented by Dr. Fatko.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Before we start our activity, our program today, let us bow our head for a moment, pray to God Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, so that our guest lecture can be precious to all of us. I will lead this prayer based on the teaching of Islam, and those who are not Islam, not Muslim, you are pleased to pray according to each your beliefs. A'udzu billahi minasyaitonir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allahumma shalli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala asrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala ali washabihi ajmain. Amma ba'du. Allah, today Wednesday September 6, 2023, in this beautiful place we gather here to attend guest lecture. Make this guest lecture as a useful medical science assembly, as a medium of sharing useful knowledge and experiences. May this guest lecture we organize today benefit to our lives and broaden our knowledge. Oh Allah, protect us from unintended temptation, show us the right path, and give us knowledge and strength to perform good things. And equally, show us and make it clear the bad things and give us knowledge and strength to avoid them. O Allah, you are the one who can fulfill our dua. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina azabannar. Amin amin ya rabbal alamin. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you.
next event, we will a short photo session. Please, our honorable guest, the Dean of Faculty of Medicine Universitas Brawijaya, Dr. Dr. Wisnu Barlianto, MSI Med Pediatric Specialist Consultant, all of our supervisor, Doctor of Radiology Department of Medical Faculty of Universitas Brawijaya, our honorable speaker, Professor James F. Griffith and Prof. Kwek Switian, and Dr. Paulus Raharjo can come to the in front of the and to take the picture. Check. Okay, thank you, Professor and Doctor. Honorable participant of the day, we would like now to start our main event for today. I will introduce to you our moderator of the day. Dr. Dini Rahma Erawati, Radiology Specialist Consultant, who is more familiarly known as Dr. Era. Dr. Era completely her professional education as radiologist on in Faculty of Medicine Universitas Brawijaya and Thoraxis Radiology Consultant in Indonesian College of Radiology. Now she serves as a functional and teaching staff at the Faculty of Medicine Universitas Brawijaya Malang and Department of Radiology Saiful Anwar General Hospital Malang. And she already published several articles focusing on thoraxis radiology in national and international journal. To Dr. Era, time is yours. Please give some applause.
Thank you, Dr. Ginanda. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope all of you excited as I am for this guest lecture. Because we have two outstanding speakers today, Professor James Griffith and Professor Kwek. I see the Professor Kwek already had a batik shirt, and it's very suitable for you and also of you, because they are made their shirt new special for welcoming two of you. Yeah. All of them with brown batiks is a student of residency program in Brawijaya University. They are very welcome for both of you. We have two outstanding speakers, expert in musculoskeletal radiology, joining us today to share their insight, knowledge, and experience also. And I'd like to take a moment to gratitude to our speaker for taking the time to be with us today. Let me introduce the speaker. The first one is Professor James Griffith, Professor Radiology at Chinese University of Hong Kong. I also already read some of your books, Prof. It's very good, excellent books. And today the lecture will he will give topics about five most commonly overlooked injuries on a knee MRI. The second one, it's also very outstanding lecturer, Professor Kwek Swe Tian, Professor of Radiology at the National University of Singapore. And if I read all of your publication, it will take time too much. So I will skip it, okay? He will bring us some topics, MR imaging of the shoulder. So before we dive in, I inform you to all of you that this lecture consists of two sections. The first is lecture session. It's about 1 hour. So the Professor James and Professor Kwek will give lecture for about 30 minutes, Prof. And the second part is Q&A section. So all of you can give any question to the expert. So without further ado, let's give a warm welcome to first speaker, Professor James F. Griffiths. 30 minutes further is for you, Professor.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. It's for the kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here, and honestly humbling to get such a reception and such a warm reception, and to see everybody looking so nice. It's really nice, very impressive. I need to take some of this back to my department. This sort of attitude, really, it's really very good, and it's a great credit to you, really. It's thank you for the invitation. I'm going to talk about the five top misses, or five top overlooked injuries in knee MRI. Now, how did I decide on these? This sort of why I decided to do this lecture is, but these are the type of things that I see when MRI examinations are reported in other centers, and I've had to review them for whatever reason. And these are the things which I think even experienced radiologists will overlook time and time again. And they're quite small things, but they're still significant, because every single anatomical structure in your body has got a purpose. And if it's torn, it does impede your knee function to some degree. And your knee is one of those joints which suffers a lot from instability. It's probably the joint which suffers most from instability. And so it may lead to patient symptoms. It may lead to later injury. And they may also lead to a perception of instability. And that's a common symptom, which is difficult. But people just don't feel that knee is quite right. And they don't feel that they can sort of go back to playing football and things like that because of that sort of feeling of instability. Now, so this is the first abnormality. The abnormal one is on the right-hand side. Your right-hand side. The normal is on the left-hand side. And the injury is around the posterior part of the knee. Anybody get it? This is a ramp lesion. When we look at the meniscus, we often look, at the dark area of the meniscus, but we kind of forget to look around the edge of the meniscus. And the ramp lesions are tears of the posterior attachment of the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. There's two ligaments here. Oops, so sorry. I'm not sure if we got a pointer there. Well, you can see these the ligaments, the meniscal femoral and meniscal tibial ligament, that you should always see soft tissue here at the back of the knee joint. So if you see this gap, that's a ramp lesion. It leads to instability of the knee, of that meniscus. So essentially, it's the peripheral longitudinal tear of the posterior horn of the medial meniscus, which is either affecting the meniscocapsular ligament or can affect the meniscotibial ligament or the red zone. I'll show you some examples later on. How does this happen? It basically usually happens in people following ACL tear. So what happens when you tear your ACL? Your tibia moves forward relative to your femur, and as a result of that, it tears the structures at the posterior aspect of your medial meniscus. It's a commonly overlooked injury that can lead to some relative instability of that meniscus, which may potentially predispose to further injury. Now, these are the different types of ramp lesions. You can see this is a normal situation around the posterior horn or medial meniscus. You've got the meniscocapsular and the meniscotibial ligaments. They're not like normal types of ligaments. They're very, very fluffy types of ligaments, but they are distinct ligamentous structures. And so it may be just at the peripheral part, it may involve a corner of the meniscus at the top corner or the bottom corner, or it may involve a thin peripheral rim of the meniscus. So sometimes you might get a double tear with both the meniscus and the meniscocapsular attachments. And these are other examples. Different types of ramp lesions. It's one of those review areas that when you're looking at an MRI examination on the sagittal images, always basically first thing you look at, is there nice tissue against the posterior horn of the medial meniscus? This is the second abnormality. And again, it's related to the meniscus. So again, I'm stressing, when you're looking at a meniscus, don't just be looking at the meniscus itself for tears, but also look around the meniscus. And these are the abnormalities here. Now, this is a normal situation on the medial side where you've got the meniscofemoral and the meniscotibial ligaments here attached, going up underneath the medial collateral ligament. This is torn on this side. On the opposite side here, these are normal, again, meniscocapsular attachments of the lateral meniscus, but here it's torn up here. Now, there's quite a wide variety in the appearances of these meniscocapsular ligaments, but again, stress to you, just always look at them. These are the review areas, bang, 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 always look at them, and eventually you'll begin to recognize a wide range of normal sort of appearances and be able to recognize an injury very quickly. So an injury to the peripheral meniscal attachments, meniscocapsular and meniscofemoral ligaments. These are what the normal ligaments look like. On the lateral side, they tend to be much longer and sort of more variable in appearance, whereas on the medial side, they tend to be shorter and more distinct. Now, this is another injury. This is normal in this situation, but the other related injury is injury to the popliteal meniscofascicles at the posterior horn of the medial meniscus, of the lateral meniscus. So here you can see the popliteus tendon, and you can see these superior and inferior popliteal meniscal fascicles. These are a constant structure. You will always see them in every single knee. So always do look out for them, but again, they vary slightly in appearance. These are tears of the meniscofemoral or popliteal meniscal fascicles. Here you can see a tear of the superior and inferior fascicle. Here again, you can see it disrupted here. And here you can see no inferior fascicle, but just some fibrous tissue as a result of a previous tear in that area. So again, all of these injuries are commonly overlooked. So do look out for these areas. This is another such an injured patient here. You can see on the sagittal image, there should normally be tissue up against the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. In this case, so the patient has got a discoid lateral meniscus. So in this case, what we did is we looked at the patient on inflection view, and you can appreciate how unstable that meniscus is on flexion. It goes from a normal position if you're scanning the knee normally, but when you flex the knee, you can appreciate this is a hypermobile lateral meniscus as a result of this tear to the anterior capsular attachment. Okay, this is the third abnormality. Does anybody spot the abnormality here? Both patients have got the same lesion. And this is a tear of the posterior root ligament, normally affecting the medial meniscus, but less commonly so the lateral meniscus. Again, you can see, you should normally see the root ligament going down into this area, but in both these cases, it's missing. Also very commonly overlooked injury. Sometimes you may see some tissue in that area, because normally it does show some hyper intense signal, even in a normal situation. So here you could say that was a severe sprain rather than a complete tear in this case, where you can't see any tissue at all. Other signs that you get with a posterior root ligament tear, you get peripheral extrusion of the meniscus. On sagittal imaging, when you're scanning across the sagittal images, you get a ghosting, you get a section where you don't see any meniscus. And if you're lucky, on axial imaging, when you're scanning on axial imaging, you may see that defect there, the posterior root ligament of the medial meniscus. Nearly always involves the medial meniscus, but occasionally can involve the lateral meniscus as well. This is what the normal ligament looks like. You should, again, always just look at this area and look to see if the root ligaments are affected or torn. It's nearly always a posterior root ligament, nearly always on the medial side, but less so on the lateral side. The anterior roots are much more stable and much less commonly torn. Now, this is a tear of the posterior root of the lateral meniscus. That's what it looks like normally. But unless you look specifically at this area, review it specifically, you will overlook because it can very, superficially, it can all look normal. There's no evidence of meniscal tear, but in fact there is. There's a big meniscal tear at the posterior root ligament. These are some more examples here. Again, posterior root ligament tears. Tends to also be more common in older patients. Okay, and then the other injury that can be overlooked is injury to the capsular ligaments. The anterior capsule of your knee joint is very, very mobile and very lax because you've got to bend your knee. But the posterior capsule of your knee joint and the posterior lateral corner and the posterior medial corner are very tight because it helps to maintain your knee when your knee is standing, when it's hyperextended, when you're standing. So these are the structures of the capsular structures of your knee joint that you've got on the medial lateral ligament, but then on the posterior medial aspect of the knee, you've got the posterior oblique ligament. Then you've got the semimembranous tendon down here. So this is a semimembranous tendon. So you've got behind that, you've got what's known as the medial posterior capsule, posterior medial capsule knee joint. Then across the along across the posterior aspect of your knee, you've got the oblique popliteal ligament, and then you've got the posterolateral capsular knee. So the only ones you need to remember are the posterior oblique ligament and the oblique popliteal ligament. They're the only ones you really need to remember. Mediocollateral ligament, oblique popliteal ligament. So what do they look like on, and how do you look evaluate these ligaments? You see them on an axial image taken around the level of the knee joint at the lower end of the condyles. So here you can see medial condyle, lateral condyle. So this here is a medial collateral ligament. That structure there is the posterior oblique ligament. And then around the back here then is the posteromedial capsule of the knee joint, all around that area. And then across here then is the oblique popliteal ligament. And across here then is the posterolateral capsule of knee joint. Previously people used to call it the arcuate ligament, but people don't use that term anymore because there's no distinct structure as the arcuate ligament. It's just called it a posterolateral capsule. And then over here then you've got the popliteus tendon and lateral collateral ligament. So look at all of these structures on, particularly in people with fairly recently injured knee injuries. And then you begin to see these types of injuries. So here you can see there's a moderate severity sprain of the posteromedial knee capsule. You can see that the mediocollateral ligament and the oblique popliteal ligament is normal, the posterior oblique ligament is normal, and also the oblique popliteal ligament is normal. And also the posterolateral capsule is normal. But in this patient is different. You can see there's a severe sprain of the posteromedial capsule and also the posterolateral capsule of the knee joint. What about this patient here? Well, you can see that there's a tear of the medial patellofemoral ligament, also a sprain of the medial collateral ligament and the oblique popliteal ligament, but the posteromedial capsule of the knee joint in this case is normal. So the medial patellofemoral ligament, medial collateral ligament, and the posterior oblique ligament are sprained, but the posteromedial capsule is intact. What about this one here then? Well, again, there's a sprain of the popliteal femoral collateral ligament. The mediocollateral ligament is mildly sprained. Again, a severe sprain of really the posteromedial capsule and all of the arcuate ligament and the posterolateral capsule doesn't look too bad. So all of these structures should be. What do you think about this one? Well, again, you can see again a severe sprain of the posteromedial capsule and the arcuate ligament, the lateral collateral and the posterolateral capsule look okay. But here it's predominantly a sprain of the posterolateral capsule. So a lot of times people do not report these sprains of the posterior capsule of the knee joint. And I think they are very important things to report, particularly in younger patients following injury and sports people as well, because they do represent a significant injury. So here you can see this is a patient that clearly had a very severe injury to the posterior knee capsule initially on initial presentation. And then 3 months later, you can see that nearly everything has completely settled down. All of that sprain injury has completely settled down. So that just as this is another area to review routinely, and you'll see injuries to these in ligaments very, very commonly on knee MRI. Okay, and this is the final one. Anybody know what the injury is here? Yeah, the ACL doesn't look quite normal, sure it doesn't. It doesn't look bad, and you could see how it could be reported as normal. But it looks very fluffy up here towards the femoral attachment. And also this ACL ligament is really just too lax. It should be going up a little bit higher towards Blumenstadt's line at the femoral attachment. So these are partial tears of the ACL. And so anytime you see an abnormal looking ligament like this, what we routinely do, this is the ACL, you've got the antromedial bundle here, the darker area, and this is the posterolateral bundle, the brighter area. Partial ACL tears about 10% of ACL tears. They may involve one bundle completely, and they may involve a part of one bundle and a part of the other bundle. But they can heal, they have got the propensity to heal, and with preservation of proprioception, because you generally lose quite a lot of proprioception when you tear your ACL completely. What we routinely do is we routinely do a double oblique axial imaging through the ACL. So you get about 10 images going, you know, at right angles to the ACL. It's extremely useful sequence. I try to do it in patients just following ACL injury or in patients in which the ACL looked abnormal on standard imaging, but the radiographers found it difficult to pick up those sort of cases, so they do it routinely. And honestly, it's a sequence we would 100% never do without. We love it, you know, really, and you only begin to love it when you start doing it. If you're doing 3D volumetric imaging, you can do the same thing by just reconstructing along that plane, but we don't do volumetric imaging of the knee. This is what it looks like when you first start looking at it. It looks a bit funny, admittedly, but this is towards the tibial attachment. This is the antromedial bundle and the posterolateral bundle, and shown here on the cadaveric specimen. So when you get to the mid portion of the knee, you can see the antromedial bundle and the posterolateral bundle, and also shown over here as well. And then when you get to the femoral attachment, which is the most common site of tear, again, you can see distinctly, very distinctly, the two bundles, the antromedial bundle and the posterolateral bundle of the ACL. So when you look at this case, when you look, that's what a PD sagittal sequence looks like. When you do the oblique axial and you look at the femoral attachment, you can see that there's been a complete tear of the posterolateral bundle and a moderate severity tear of the antromedial bundle. So you can give a very specific report saying the posterolateral bundle has been completely torn, and there's a tear also of the antromedial bundle, probably involving about 30%. Now, definitely that's a lot of guesswork, but you'd have to say that about 30% of the tendons are probably torn. This is the other patient then. You could see again the ACL looked normal, and when you do oblique axial, in this case you can see the antromedial bundle is completely torn, and the posterolateral bundle, there's a mild tear to the posterolateral bundle again. So you could say a complete tear of the antromedial bundle, but with a partial tear of the posterolateral bundle, probably involving about 20% of the fibers or something like that. So you can be very specific. So if you don't routinely use it, at least try to use it, call those patients back where you suspect there might be a partial ACL tear. You know, we always think the ACL is easy to diagnose. It's definitely not easy. You know, it's one of those areas where it's often you're scratching your head thinking, is the ACL normal or is it not normal? This is an absolute problem solver in all of those cases, using this double oblique axial imaging. So do routinely check for ramp tears. Routinely check at the peripheral aspects of the meniscus for capsular tears. Also routinely look at the roots of the menisci, particularly the posterior root of the medial meniscus. Look for capsular ligament tears along the posterior capsule of the knee joint. Again, you'll see those very, very commonly. You can be very specific saying that the moderate severity tear of the posterior oblique ligament with a mild sprain of the posterior medial knee capsule. You can be very specific about those abnormalities, and also look for partial ACL tears, considering doing double oblique axial imaging. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor James, for the lecture. So we have to emphasize that the in evaluate the MR of the knee, especially in injury problem, we have consider about the five area that's overlooks easily. Okay, thank you. I think there's some question for you, but I think it's after the professor quick lecture. So we continue to the next lecture presented by Professor Kwek Si Tian. Sorry, Professor. About 30 minutes for, further is yours. In the Q&A session, maybe the audience could have a question for the professor, but also the professor maybe have any quiz for the residents. It's very they already heart beating over there. Thank you. Please, professor.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Irawati, for the kind introduction, and thank you to all of you, particularly your head of department, for so kindly hosting us and for the warm hospitality. It's a great honor and pleasure to be here. I thought today I would share a little on MR imaging of the shoulder. MR imaging of the shoulder has a special meaning for me when I was at the same stage as many of the residents here. In those days, MR of the shoulder was relatively uncommon. We would see one every couple of days. So as residents, we would all rush to report them. Of course, MR of the shoulder is much more common now. I think in most practices, it would account for at least 5 to 10% of most musculoskeletal practices. But although it has become more common, I find that many of my fellows and residents still are not as comfortable reporting MR of the shoulder as they are MR of the spine or MR of the knee. So I thought today we will have a look at this, focusing on two of the key pathologies that clinicians refer these patients to us for. The first is to look at rotator cuff pathology, and the second to look for causes of shoulder instability. We will focus primarily on the first, and in the last part of this lecture, we will just round up by looking at instability. Now, tendons of the rotator cuff tend to are similar to tendons elsewhere in the body. And there are only two key pathologies that they tend to that we tend to see. The first is tendinosis, and the other is tendon tears. Now, tendinosis refers to degeneration of the tendon, and it presents with thickening of the tendon. Some of you may come across the term tendinitis or even tendinopathy when you read the literature. Now, what is the difference between tendinitis and tendinosis? Tendinosis, as we have seen, is due to degeneration of the tendon, whereas tendinitis refers to inflammation of the tendon. Tendinopathy is a broader term that encompasses both tendinitis and tendinosis, but most people tend to use them interchangeably. And that's because on imaging, they look the same. Basically, with tendinosis, all you see is thickening of the tendon like so, with increased signal within it. So diagnosis of tendinosis is fairly straightforward. The only thing you need to be careful of is the magic angle phenomenon. This is an MR artifact that occurs on sequences with low TE, and that would be the T1 and PD weighted sequences, where you get an artifactual high signal of the tendon when they run at about 55 degrees to the magnetic field. All right, so the key to avoid this really is to use the T2 weighted sequences to look for tendinosis, which I'm sure most of you, if not all of you, are doing now. Now, when some people report tendinosis, they tend to divide them into mild, moderate, or severe tendinosis. As far as I know, there is no good classification to divide them into these categories. In terms of management, the management for tendinosis is really rest, perhaps some analgesics, and activity modification. So what may come as a surprise to many of you is that clinicians are often not too affected by whether we call tendinosis or not. Often, in fact, it has no major practical impact, because when a patient sees an orthopedic surgeon for shoulder pain, the standard treatment is going to be rest and modification of activity anyway, regardless of whether we call tendinosis or not. What the clinician is more interested in is tendon tear. Now, tendon tear may be due to various pathology, commonly traumatic or degenerative, or a combination of both. But whatever the cause of tendon tear, you basically only have two types of tendon tear. One, the partial thickness tear, and the other, the full thickness tear. Now, partial thickness tear, as the name implies, involves only one part of the tendon. So what parts of the tendon can it involve? It can involve the part that is closer to the joint or the articular surface, and that is an articular-sided tendon tear, and this is the most common type of partial thickness tendon tear. It can involve the substance of the tendon itself, and this is called an interstitial or intrasubstance tendon tear, or it can involve the part of the tendon that lies against the bursa here, and that is the bursal-sided tendon tear. What many of you would describe for partial thickness tendon tears would be the tendon involved, the region of the tendon that is affected, and the size of the tendon. But what I find some of my fellows or residents not reporting really is the depth of the tendon tear. Now, there's a very well-established classification which grades these tears according to the size into grade 1, 2, and 3 tendon tears, partial thickness tendon tears. And this applies whether it affects the articular-sided tendon tears or the bursal-sided partial thickness tendon tears. To all practical purposes, one simple way of assessing the depth of partial thickness tendon tear is to look at the thickness of the tendon itself, all right? We know that the normal thickness of the tendon is about 12 millimeters. So what I do is I eyeball. So if you see something like that, that involves more than half the tendon, you know that it is going to be a grade 3 tendon, partial thickness tendon tear. Now, some of you may ask, what about the grade 1 and grade 2 partial thickness tendon tears? Well, I don't really distinguish the two of them because for a few reasons. Now, take a look at this image. Is this a grade 1 or a grade 2 partial thickness tendon tear? If you move the cursor a bit more, it becomes grade 2. If you move the cursor less, it becomes grade 1. So for small tendon tears like that, there is a lot of intra and inter-observer variability, and trying to distinguish them, in my opinion, is relatively inaccurate. The second and more important reason I don't bother to distinguish the two is, again, it has got no major practical impact. If you look at the management of partial thickness tendon tears, of course, the decision on whether to operate or not depends on various factors, including patient's age, the pre-morbid status, the patient's activities. But generally, surgeons will only operate if it is a grade 3 tendon partial thickness tendon tears. For grade 1 and 2 partial thickness tendon tears, the management is going to be conservative. So don't spend too much time trying to distinguish the two. Now, what is more important is for you to recognize this special type of partial thickness tendon tear, and this is called a Rembrandt tear. Now, historically, you know, we have been taught that tendon tears tend to occur at what is known as the critical zone, and this is an area that is about 1 centimeter from the insertion of the tendon. Now, it is thought that this area is relatively hypovascular, and therefore, that makes it more prone to tears. But over time, we have learned that another common site of tendon tear is where it inserts into the bone or the greater tuberosity. and that is known as the footprint area. Now, if you have a partial thickness articular sided tendon tear, as indicated by this green line here, that is what is known as a Rembrandt tear. So the common plane to look for this would be on the coronal oblique plane. But if you can imagine, you know, the long head of the tendon, of the long head of the biceps tendon arises here and it runs in this direction. So the other plane that you can try to look for this tendon, this Rembrandt tear, is on the sagittal image near where the long head of the biceps tendon runs. And here you can see the Rembrandt tear like so. Now, why is it important to diagnose Rembrandt tears? Well, it is a fairly common tear. In fact, something that it is even more common than tears at the critical zone. And the other is that it is an easily overlooked partial thickness tear unless you look specifically for it. And some people think that Rembrandt tears are quite likely to progress to full thickness tears. And that's why it's important to look for these. Now, while we are focused on the supraspinatus tendon, do remember that these tears can occur in other tendons, in particular in the infraspinatus. So don't forget to look for these there as well. Now, the second common type of partial thickness tear is the interstitial or intrasubstance tear that you see here. And these are tears that occur along the long axis of the tendon. So usually you can see them very well in two planes, both the coronal oblique as well as the sagittal planes. Now, if you look at these tears, because they occur along the long axis of the tendon, there is a tendency for the tears to extend along the tendon. Now, we all know that collagen fibers in the tendons are very tightly packed. So generally, there is a tendency for them to extend more proximally to involve the muscle itself because the muscle fibers here are less tightly packed. And when they do so, you can occasionally see the formation of an intramuscular cyst like so. So when you do see an intramuscular cyst in this case, do remember to look carefully for associated interstitial tears. Now, why is it important for us to be able to identify the interstitial tears? Well, because they occur within the substance of the tendon itself, you find that your arthroscopist is not going to be able to see them. The other reason it is important to identify these tears is that because of their tendency to extend into the muscles and along the tendon, they are thought to be associated with a worse prognosis or a worse surgical outcome. So some surgeons prefer not to operate in these patients. Now, the third type of partial thickness tear, as we have seen, are those that involve the bursal surface. And here you see two examples of it. One that occurs at the footprint region, and we will revisit this again slightly later, and the other that occurs along the critical zone that we saw earlier on. But generally, bursal-sided tears are relatively uncommon, and some people think that they account for less than 5% of all partial thickness tears. Now, if those were the only three types of partial thickness tears we have to contend with, life would be fairly straightforward. Unfortunately, people have introduced special terms for various subtypes of partial thickness tears, and that has caused a bit of confusion and complicated things somewhat. So let's take a look at three of these special types of partial thickness tears. The first is the pasta lesion. PASTA stands for partial articular surface tendon avulsion tear. So basically, as the name suggests, you have a tear that a partial articular surface tear and the tendon is avulsed off the bone. And this is what it looks like. So the PASTA lesion is really similar to the Rembrandt lesion. Now, you can also have a similar lesion, but it occurs on the bursal sided surface. And that is known as the reverse pasta lesion. And this is the lesion that we saw earlier on. Now, the second type of special tear is the pain lesion, and pain stands for partial articular with intratendinous extension. So what you see is a small articular sided tear, but there is a larger intratendinous or interstitial component, like what you see here. And in these cases, although the arthroscopist is able to see the small articular sided tear, what they cannot appreciate is the larger intratendinous component. And that's why it's important to highlight it to them so that they are aware, as it would often require more extensive surgery. Now, the third type of partial thickness tear is the CID lesion, or the concealed interstitial delamination tear. And this is a tear that occurs at the footprint region, and as the term implies, it is an interstitial tear. So again, this is a tear that the arthroscopist cannot see on his scope, but it is something that we can bring to their attention. Next, we move on to full thickness tears. Now, in full thickness tears, the tear extends all the way across the thickness of the tendon. So you find that the joint fluid usually extends into the subacromial subdeltoid bursa, and this helps to make the tear more visible. But beyond knowing the fact that there is a full thickness tear, what does the clinician want to know? Well, there are a number of things that we should tell them about. The first is the condition of the edge of the tendon, right? So if you have a frayed tendon like so, it is important to mention it to the clinician, because it would involve more debridement and more extensive surgery than a clean tear. Now, the second thing that they would like to know is the size of the tear. And the third thing is the degree of tendon retraction. Other things that we should tell them is also the state of the muscle itself, whether there is atrophy or fatty infiltration of the muscle. Now, before we take a deeper look into this, I would like to introduce to you the concept of a complete and incomplete full thickness tear. Now, this is something that I found surprising, because when I speak to some of the orthopedic residents, they are also not aware of what the difference is. When we look at a full thickness tear, usually the diagnosis is made on the coronal oblique image. But we must remember that the tendon is a three-dimensional structure. So there is not only the cranial caudal component, there is the anterior posterior component. So you can have a partial thickness tear that involves only one part of the tendon like so, and that is known as an incomplete full thickness tear. On the other hand, the tear can also extend along the whole width of the tendon, as in this case, and that is a complete full thickness tear. So the thing to remember is that when we assess full thickness tendon tears, look at it not just in the coronal oblique position, but also assess it on the sagittal images. So in this case, we have a full thickness tear on the coronal oblique view, but if you look at it on the sagittal view, you can see that part of the tendon, the anterior part, is still intact. So this is an incomplete full thickness tear. Now, on the other hand, if you look at this other patient, there is a full thickness tear on the coronal oblique view, and on the sagittal view, you don't see the supraspinatus tendon at all. So this is a complete full thickness tear. And obviously, it is in the complete full thickness tear that is more extensive, and where they are more concerned about the size of the tear and tendon retraction. So in terms of the size of tendon tear, basically, there is a very well accepted system as proposed by DiOrio and Caulfield, that divides them into small, medium, large, or massive tear based on the size. And generally, for massive tears, the treatment is conservative. What is quite closely associated with the size of the tendon tear is the tendon retraction. And often, clinician wants us to tell them whether it's retracted to the level of the mid-humeral head or to the joint line or proximal to the glenoid. And again, if they are more retracted, the surgeon is less likely to go in because the outcome is going to be poor. Now, other factors that involve the decision as to whether to operate or not would involve whether there is atrophy or fatty infiltration of the muscle. Atrophy is best assessed on the sagittal view, where you draw a line from the coronoid to from the coracoid to the spine of the scapula. And if the muscle lies above this, that's normal. If it just touches this line, that's mild atrophy, and then you have moderate and severe atrophy. So in this case, if you draw a line here, you can see that the muscle bulk lies above it, that's normal. In this case, if you draw a line here, you can see that the muscle does not reach this line. So this is mild to moderate atrophy. And finally, in this case, without even drawing the line, you can tell that this is severe atrophy. Now, for quite a long time, I must confess, I used to associate atrophy with fatty infiltration. So I did not really report very much on fatty infiltration. And then one day I learned the subtle difference between the two. Although they are closely associated, there is a slight difference. If you have atrophy, as in this case, with no significant fatty infiltration, the surgeon may still operate on the patient because you can regain the muscle bulk with physiotherapy and exercise. But if you have atrophy with fatty infiltration, like in this patient, usually the surgeon will not operate on the patient because you are not going to regain the muscle bulk even with physiotherapy and exercise. So in terms of fatty infiltration, there is a very well-established system to classify this, the Guttelier's classification, although some people propose a simpler system to classify the fatty infiltration. Now, so far, we have been looking at mainly at the supraspinatus muscle, and most of what we have mentioned for the supraspinatus tendon also applies to the other rotator cuff tendons. But there are special features of tears of the other rotator cuff tendons that we will take a quick look at. Probably one of the more important other tendons to look at is the infraspinatus tendon. And again, I must confess that for a long time, this was one tendon that I used to ignore. But you find that not uncommonly, you get infraspinatus tendon tears in association with tears of the supraspinatus, especially if the tear involves the posterior part of the supraspinatus tendon. And obviously, when you have a combined infra and supraspinatus tear, the postoperative outcome is going to be less favorable. Isolated tears of the infraspinatus tendon may also happen, and that tends to happen more in patients who are involved in throwing sports like javelin and so forth. And that has to do with the internal impingement by the posterior superior labrum when they abduct and externally rotate their shoulder. Now, the subscapularis muscle is a multi-pennant muscle, so it's got a few tendon slips, and usually the pathology tends to involve the more superior aspect of the tendon, and we will see why later on. One important thing to remember about subscapularis tendon tear is to look for associated biceps tendon injury. A simple way of remembering this is to think that part of the subscapularis tendon actually extends across as the transverse humeral ligament. Although that's very simplistic and not totally true, that's something I find easy to remember. So if you do have a subscapularis tendon tear, do look out for associated biceps tendon subluxation or dislocation. As with the infraspinatus tendon tears, subscapularis tendon tears are often associated with supraspinatus tendon tears. So do look out for these as well. Now, finally, we have tears of the teres minor tendon, and that's something that I don't worry too much about. Isolated tears of the teres minor tendon are extremely uncommon. I don't know whether James has seen any, but I've not seen isolated tears of the tendon itself. Most times when we see tears of the teres minor tendon, it is seen in association with other more important injuries, such as posterior dislocation of the shoulder, where you can have an associated capsular injury, as in this patient, or they occur as part of a massive rotator cuff tears involving multiple rotator cuff tendons, in which case the treatment is going to be conservative anyway. So it's not going to change the clinician's management of the patient. Now, on top of tendinosis and tendon tears, the other thing that clinicians often want to know when they treat these patients is, are there factors that predispose the patient to the tendon tears? Because when they treat the patient for the tendon tear, they also need to treat the predisposing factor. If not, the patient is likely to re-tear the tendon again. And one of the important predisposing factors that they want to know about is whether there is impingement of the tendon. Now, there is external and internal impingement, but in the interest of time, I will just run through the more common and more important external impingement. Now, most times when we look at external impingement, most of us will just look at the subacromial impingement, but there is also the less well-known subcoracoid impingement that we will take a quick look at. But first, the subacromial impingement. Now, I like to use the sagittal view to look at subacromial impingement. Basically, if you look at this area that is outlined by the dotted lines, that is where the supraspinatus muscle and tendon will run. And if you look at this region, you find that it is marked out by four structures. The first is the acromion. The second is the acromial clavicular joint or the distal clavicle. What you don't see but is there is this third structure, which is the subacromial subdeltoid bursa. And finally, you have the fourth structure, which is this coracoacromial ligament. So abnormalities of any of these four structures that causes narrowing of this region can result in subacromial impingement. So this could involve soft tissue abnormalities such as chronic thickening of the bursa or calcification in the coracoacromial ligament. Although generally the soft tissue structures are not the ones that cause problems. Usually the ones that cause problems are the bony structures, which is the acromion as well as the acromial clavicular joint. Now, in terms of the acromion, I think many of you are familiar with the different types of acromion. I just want to remind you that it is this type 3 acromion with the inferior hook that is the one that tends to cause the subacromial impingement. You can appreciate how the inferior hook can potentially impinge on the supraspinatus that will lie in this region. Now, in terms of the acromial clavicular joint, the common pathology that causes impingement is when you have osteoarthritic changes with inferior osteophytic lipping like that. So you can imagine how the inferior osteophytes will impinge on the supraspinatus muscle and tendon as it runs laterally across in this case. Now, next we look at subcoracoid impingement. As the subscapularis muscle and tendon runs laterally across to insert into the lesser tuberosity, it runs through a very narrow space that is bounded anteriorly by the coracoid and posteriorly by the humerus, what is known as the coracohumeral interval. Now you can imagine that when this interval is narrowed by osteophytes in this case, it can actually impinge on the subscapularis tendon and predispose to tendinosis and tendon tears. So this is a case where there's narrowing of the coracohumeral space to less than 6 millimeters, and you can see the increased signal within the subscapularis tendon due to tendinosis. Next, we move quickly to look at shoulder instability, which is the second common pathology that clinicians refer patients to us for MRI. Now, the shoulder joint, as we know, is a ball and socket joint, and some people have likened it to a ball sitting on a tee like so. So you can understand how this can be easily knocked off. Now, there are two main groups of stabilizers of the shoulder joint. One is the rotator cuff, which forms the dynamic stabilizer. You can imagine the rotator cuff as four fingers of the hand holding the humeral head to the glenoid. And you can appreciate how injury to any of these structures could therefore predispose to instability. The second is really the glenolabral ligamentous complex, which forms the static stabilizers. So to understand how they provide stability to the joint, let us look at this schematic diagram. Now here you can see that the cartilage overlying the glenoid, and it's a relatively flat surface. And when this articulates with the rounded humeral head, there is obviously instability. So how the labrum provides for increased stability is that you see that the labrum forms a cuff around this. And straight away, you can see that the labrum deepens the concavity for articulation with the head, and it also increases the surface area for articulation with the head. So the labrum, together with the glenohumeral joint, as well as the joint capsule, provides some static stability to the joint. And injury to these structures can therefore predispose to instability. Now, there are many pathologies that can predispose to injuries to that area. And again, in the interest of time, I can only take you through the more common ones. And this is the classic Bankart lesion, the Bankart variants, as well as the slab lesion. So in terms of the Bankart lesion, it is a true and true tear of the labrum. So this is an example of the Bankart lesion. And you can see that the anterior articulation surface is actually detached, and therefore this predisposes to anterior instability. And often when you get a Bankart lesion, you can look for the associated Hill-Sack lesion or the impaction fracture. Now this is another type of Bankart lesion. And you can see that not only is the labrum gone, part of the bone has been displaced. And you can see that there is even greater reduction of the articulation surface. So this predisposes to even greater instability. And you can see that on the neutral position, there is already some anterior subluxation of the joint. And when you have Bankart lesions, you can also have similar lesions on the posterior aspect, and that is what is known as a reverse Bankart lesion. Now, in terms of the Bankart variants, there are only two of them that you need to know. One is the Perthes lesion. Perthes is in a way half a Bankart. What you have is detachment of the labrum, but it still remains attached to the scapular periosteum. So this is an example of a Perthes lesion. And because it is still partially attached to the scapular periosteum, it may be an undisplaced or only mildly displaced lesion. And it is something that you see better with MR arthrogram, and in particular, if you perform the MR arthrogram in the upper view. Now next is the Elpsa lesion. UPSIR stands for anterior labral ligamentous periosteal sleeve avulsion injury. So in this case, what's happened is the labrum has been displaced medially and it lies against the scapula like so. So you can see again, the concavity for articulation with the humeral head here is lost, and that predisposes to instability. And here we see two examples of UPSIR lesion, one slightly more acute with an irregular margin and the other a chronic injury with a more rounded appearance like so. Now finally, the slab lesion. These are labral tears that involve the superior labrum. There are many different subtypes of these tears, and usually I just describe the tear as I see it. All right, so the site to look for the tears is in the superior labrum, and to remember the orientation of the tear, they run within the substance of the labrum themselves. And if you look at the meniscus in the knee, you can get a meniscal cyst in association with this. And likewise with these labral tears, you can get parameniscal cysts. So if you do see a paralabral cyst, that is a good diagnostic hint that you are looking at a labral tear. So remember to look carefully for associated labral tears. Basically, the major pitfalls are really the labral variants that we have alluded to earlier on. And with labral variants, do remember to look at the orientation of the tear in the superior labrum. You can have normal variants such as sublabral foramen or sublabral sulcus, and usually those run along the base of the labrum, whereas if you do have a tear of the labrum, it tends to run along the substance of the labrum like so. A common rule of thumb to distinguish the two is to look at the site of involvement. Basically, if you look, most of the labral lesions involve the anterior inferior labrum, like the Bancutt lesion and the Bancutt variants, whereas most of the variants involve the superior aspect of the labrum. So in summary, we have had a quick look at rotator cuff pathology as well as some of the causes of instability. For rotator cuff pathology, remember just two things that they usually are affected by. One is tendinosis and the other is tears. With tears, again, you just have to remember two types of tears, the partial thickness tears and the full thickness tears. With partial thickness tears, just remember there are three types of partial thickness tears: the articular-sided tears, the interstitial tears, as well as the bursal-sided tears. And of course, you do have a few special tears that we have looked at briefly. With full thickness tears, these are some of the important factors that you will need to tell your referring clinician. And on top of that, you have to look for causes that may predispose these patients to the tendinosis or tears, because this would be something that the clinician would also have to treat. And the main cause really is to look for causes of impingement. In terms of instability, remember that there are dynamic and static stabilizers. The dynamic stabilizers we have already looked at with a rotator cuff tendon pathology. And for the static stabilizers, the key pathology that predisposes them to instability are these labral lesions. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Quek. Welcome, Professor Rossi. Professor Rossi ini sebentar lagi mau dikukuhkan ya. Jadi please applause dulu buat Professor Rossi. Alhamdulillah, jadi radiologi ini tambah banyak profesornya. Before Q&A session, we have also Dr. Paulus ya. Dr. Paulus itu guru buat saya, buat kita semua ya. Jadi mungkin additional teacher for this guest lecture is Dr. Paulus akan mungkin bisa memberikan semacam emphasize ya, Dok, dari lecture Prof. James and Profesor Quek, buat residents ya, apa sih yang penting, apa sih yang perlu dijadikan? Saya juga nggak tahu apa nanti Dokter Paulus nanti ngasih soal-soal susah apa enggak ya pada ujian board examination. Is there any Bankart lesion or Hill-Sachs lesion? I don't know exactly, but maybe Dr. Paulus can give any comment about the lecture, maybe what kind of not conclusion, but what should we teaching point for this lecture. Nggak apa-apa ya, Dr. Paulus ya. Silakan Dr. Paulus.
I don't want to repeat, but I just want to motivate you. What you learn today might save your patients tomorrow. What you miss today, learning what these professors are teaching us, all of us, might harm your patients. So if needed, you have to go back and watch the video and recording again. If you don't understand, you discuss among your own. And even if you still don't understand, we have a professor here. That's good. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Paulus. So we go through the Q&A session. Maybe the audience want to give any question for the lecture itself. Maybe you want to know about what exactly do we need to recognize easily the injury itself or other. Okay. Dr. Iis. You may go to the in front. The microphone is. Oh, Professor Quek and Professor James, sorry. You may go to the in front because the microphone is in the.
Thank you, Prof. Doctor, for the explaining the interesting case in that lecture. In the previous lecture, that was mentioned earlier that in capsular ligamentar mentioned that some of them are not visible there in extension position, but visible in flexion position. Is this technique always carried out routinely, or just only the patient have certain complaint we do? Thank you, Doctor.
I think it is for Professor James. Yeah. Special position for the injury.
Yeah, thank you for the question.
Sorry.
Thank you for the question. No, we don't routinely do flexion views to assess meniscal mobility, but we did it just in that case because.
No, because the patient was complaining of intermittent locking of the knee joint, and that was really a very exceptional case.
Oh, okay.
But knee flexion is very good when you have. I showed you how double oblique axial imaging is good for looking at number one, to confirm that the ACL is normal and is also good for looking for chronic, you know, partial tears of the ACL. But if you've got a situation where you try to distinguish between a severe tear of the ACL and a complete tear of the ACL, then flexion view is very good in those situations.
Yeah, so it is not routinely done, but the section could be done in, if it is very important to do.
We routinely do flexion in just two situations. Number one is if you've got a suspected severe partial tear of the ACL, to distinguish mm-hmm. that between a complete ACL tear, because double oblique axial is not that helpful in that situation. Okay. And the other thing we routinely do, flexion imaging of the knee, sagittal flexion, is in the evaluation of ACL grafts. Okay. It's extremely helpful there because you've got a lot of fibrosis and the graft right in the middle of the knee joint. It's very difficult to sometimes tell whether the graft is partially torn or diffusely attenuated. But again, if you do a flexion view, it's extremely helpful in that situation. So we routinely do it in that situation.
Okay. Thank you, Professor.
Sagittal plane, yes.
Okay, I hope those answers fulfill your eagerness. And is there any question for, is there another? Okay, Dr. Gunawan.
Yeah, thank you for the lecture today. I want to ask to Professor Quek, you say that there is two type of impingement in the shoulder. What impingement? What is the key point from the impingement that we have to put in our report? Thank you.
So I think one, we saw the anatomical structures that can cause impingement. But for example, if you have that anatomical variant, say a type 3 acromial hook, you also have to look at the structure itself. It may cause narrowing, but if there is no tendinosis, no symptoms, usually I just mention it, but say that there is no tendinosis. So it may cause narrowing, but there's no significant impingement. For the acromial clavicular joint, there are some studies that suggest that if you have an osteophyte that is more than 2 millimeters, inferior osteophyte that is more than 2 millimeters, that can cause impingement. But again, you need to see whether it is causing any tendinosis.
So besides the impingement itself, we should examine the tendinosis.
The effect of whether there is actually any major effect on the tendon.
Oh yeah, yes. In the tendon. Okay. Another question for the professors? Okay, Dr. Wisni.
Thank you, Professor. My name is Wisni. I want to ask some question, maybe.
To Professor James or
Professor James and Quek. Professor Quek.
Yeah.
For Professor James, you have said earlier about a hypermobility of meniscus, and we see the hypermobility of meniscus is normal in usual MRI. So when do we need to suspect this? Yes, as hypermobility meniscus, and when do we need to do the flexion and extension MRI? Second question to Professor Quek. Does MR arthrography has a role in diagnosing pathology of rotator cuff? As you said about it. Thank you, Doctor. Professor.
Yeah, thank you again for the question. I think don't get too concerned about meniscal hypermobility. It's very uncommon. Our macroscopic meniscal hypermobility is a very uncommon thing. So we would not routinely and very, very rarely do flexion views to look at that. Mm. I think the most important message is to try to always look at the periphery capsular attachments of the meniscus. And that's probably leading to a very tiny degree of micro instability of the meniscus, which may be causing some symptoms related to patient stability and maybe predisposing them to, you know, additional tears. But we other than sort of just looking at the macroscopic appearances or the morphological appearances, there's no indication to routinely do flexion imaging of the knee or other type of imaging to look at meniscal mobility. Maybe in the future it might be, people might find a way to do that, but at the moment it's not really sort of worthwhile doing that. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for the question. You are absolutely right in that MR arthrography has been shown to be useful in detecting tears. Obviously, they are more useful for the articular-sided tears, because when you inject the contrast, that's where it will outline the articular-sided partial thickness tears. If you look, articular-sided partial thickness tears accounts for the majority of the partial thickness tears. Some people estimate they account for 70 to 80% of the tears. So in theory, they are useful. In practice, I must say that at least in my practice, I don't do MR arthrography to look for rotator cuff tears, although I do them to look for instability. The reason is that MR arthrography is not very convenient for both the patient as well as for us. You've got to coordinate the arthrogram as well as the MR studies. For the patient, there is the arthrographic study, which is not very comfortable. It's not too painful, but still it's not that comfortable, and it's a little bit more costly. And I think then we go back to what I said about the articular-sided partial thickness tears. If you have a grade 3 articular-sided partial thickness tears, most times you will be able to diagnose that even without MR arthrography. If you're doing MR arthrography, and in fact some of my images are MR arthrography images, to look for a grade 1 articular-sided partial thickness tear, there is no practical change to the patient's management. The grade 1 tear, they are going to manage it conservatively. So why put the patient through the extra pain and the cost, and we take a longer time to perform the study? So in practice, the short answer is no, we don't do that. Although if you read the literature, there are papers that say it improves the rate of detection.
Thank you, Professor Quek. I think the explanation is very clear. The time still have, we have still times for the discussion. Okay. Maybe you can introduce yourself. Yeah. Ini Prof. Rosi bawa pasukan.
Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Ratia. I'm from Universitas Airlangga. My question is for Professor James. So from your previous presentation, we should mention the six things that in the area, one of them is the partial ACL tear, that we know that diagnosis remains challenging to us. So my question is, do you have any experience or tips to that key findings of the diagnosis so we don't miss the partial tear itself? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for that good question. Basically, it's when you're looking at the ACL, if it looks funny, first what you should do is of course look at all of the sequences, the sagittal, coronal, and the axial images. But we routinely, on every single knee, do oblique axial imaging, double oblique axial imaging of the ACL. And it's a game changer with respect to, you know, evaluating, determining whether the ACL is normal or whether there's a partial tear. We've gone from having a lot of uncertainty in reports to having absolutely no uncertainty whatsoever. Honestly, it's only when you start trying doing it routinely did you begin to believe in it, and everybody who does it, they would never ever do without it, that sequence. It's just a double oblique, so it gives you about 10, 12 images, you know, oblique, you know, at right angles to the ACL, where you can clearly see the anteromedial bundle, the posterolateral bundle. And the radiographers don't mind planning it because they plan it against the coronal sequence and the sagittal sequence. And okay, once they've got a little bit of, you know, experience of doing that, they can do it very quickly, and they're very happy with the sequence, and we're very happy with it. So if you want to diagnose partial ACL tears, that 100% is the way to go. Now, of course, if you're doing volumetric imaging of the knee, you can just simply do reconstructions along that plane, and that will also give you the exact same information.
So the additional section, oblique for the double oblique, yeah, for the ligament, ICL. It's very important, yeah, Professor.
It's very,
yeah,
very useful. Yes. Sequence, yes.
Okay, is it up for you? Okay. Maybe other residents want to give any question? Professor Yun? No. Okay, Dr. Jo, you may give a question.
Thank you, Professor and Doctor, for the opportunity. So my name is Johanna. I would like to ask a question to Professor Quek. So maybe in patient with rotator cuff tear that underwent either maybe conservative or surgical procedure, what's the best time to evaluate patient's condition with MRI? And what structure that we need to evaluate, and what is the imaging appearance that we expect to be happen in the patient? Thank you, Prof.
For post reconstruction, is it? Oh, for conservative. when is the best time to
surgical?
Oh. Okay, I think post-surgical, the best time to evaluate is when the patients develop the symptoms. Usually, you know, following any trauma or any symptoms, that's probably when they have the effusion. And the effusion can act as a substitute for the MR arthrogram because it can show the structures within it much better. For conservative, it really depends on a patient-to-patient case. In fact, for many of the older patients that are not going to be treatable surgically, or if I don't think that they are going to treat the patient surgically, I often advise them to just do an ultrasound for follow-up. That's a cheaper option. I don't know about the healthcare cost in Indonesia, but in Singapore, it can be quite expensive. An MR can cost, set the patient back by $800 or $900. An ultrasound only sets them back by $100.
Okay, ultrasound still have the place for evaluation post-therapeutic procedure. Yeah, Dr. Johanna. Bagaimana waktunya, masih ada? Masih. Oh, 5 minutes more. Is there any question from the residents? Okay. If... Okay, Dr. Downsloping acromion.
So downsloping has meant that there are the acromion is angulated downward.
Because of degenerative or injury? Ovarian.
Logically, it might cause effusion.
I guess what we do in our practice is a sort of templated report, and we always report the acromial type as one of the factors. But you are absolutely right. I think the concepts do change with time. People would talk about the inferior hook impinging on the muscle and tendon, but like one of the residents asked earlier on, you know, one of the things we look at is whether there is effect on the tendon. You may have an anatomical structure that theoretically can impinge on the tendon, but whether it has that effect, we still look at the tendon to see whether there's tendinosis or so. Having said that, if you look at how many of the surgeons practice, when they do tendon repair, they usually couple that with acromioplasty.
So I don't do any specific measurements, but I would report it reasonably commonly if it's, so I just eyeball it and then say there's mild, moderate, severe lateral downsloping of the acromion, and just basically leave it like that then. Nothing, no particular measurements or anything.
Okay. Dr. Nan, I want to ask a question, I think. Please, Dr. Nan.
Thank you very much, Professor. I would like to about the labrum variant. There are so many labrum variants, so would you mind to tell us about the how to distinguish between the labrum variant and the labrum tear? Thank you very much.
Thanks for the question. As you can gather, I was rushing towards the last bit of my talk to try and keep within the time. I think there are a couple of variants that can be mistaken for tears. One is the Buford complex, which I showed a picture, but I didn't even mention it. Basically, you have an absence of part of the labrum, and you have a thickened middle glenohumeral ligament, and that can mimic a band cut lesion. So as with all anatomical structure, the way to distinguish it is to follow the ligament along its course, and then you can see that that's actually a ligament rather than part of a torn labrum. The other variant that is commonly confused with a tear would be in the superior labrum, where you can have the sublabral sulcus or the sublabral foramen. And for that, you can imagine if this is the labrum. If you have a variant, it is going to run along the base of the labrum. So it runs in this direction. But if you have a tear, most times the tears occur in this other direction. So it would occur in the direction of the straw rather than along the base of the labrum. And then, of course, you can try to look for whether there are associated features like a paralabral cyst that would suggest that it's more likely a tear than just a simple variant. I hope that answers your question.
That's enough, Dr. Nan? Okay. Okay, I think we almost. Oh, Prof. Rossi, please.
As well, so what we'd like to ask that where's the exact locations or the most common location that we can consider as the REM lesions, or maybe what kind of feature that we can see on the REM lesions? Thank you.
So I think the important thing is just to always routinely on the sagittal images look at the posterior horn of the medial meniscus, the capsular attachment there, and just get a very good idea about what is a normal variation. So ramp lesions, like any other tear, can vary from the minuscule to the very severe. And so if there's any sort of, there should be tissue up against the posterior horn or the medial meniscus at all times. Sometimes ramp lesions can be very small and sometimes incomplete. So I'd report them as that. I'd say there's a small incomplete ramp tear involving the, you know, meniscocapsular, involving the meniscotibial ligament. And just, but the ramp lesion is only really meant to be significant from a surgical point of view if it's greater than 1 centimeter in length. So I'd look on how many sequences there is the ramp tear, and if it's quite large, I'd give a measurement.
So how is the correlation with the clinical, clinically?
So in our hospital, they don't even treat ramp tears. Uh-huh. But in America, they routinely treat ramp tears but you've got to use a separate portal to treat them. And they think that, you know, that when they're doing the ACL reconstructions, they will routinely treat them because they think they're significant. But most surgeons in Asia do not treat ramp tears, but it doesn't mean that we shouldn't report them. They're still significant, but they won't actually affect patient management. Definitely not in our hospital because they don't treat them specifically. And I've never seen, but in America, and probably parts of Europe, they routinely do treat them.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Professor. A lot of professor over here. It is very lucky for us to get this guest lecture itself, because a lot of speaker, a lot of professor over here, and we very blessed about it. I think we have reached the end of the insightful guest lecture this afternoon. I want to extend our heartfelt gratitude to Professor James and to Professor Quek for sharing their expertise and experience with us. To the audience, thank you also for your active participation, question, and discussion. I encourage you, all of the residents, to take the knowledge and inspiration you've gained and apply it in your daily activity, especially in MSK MR imaging. Maybe you want to ask why the moderator is from thoracic radiology, because I want to give you oxygen for all of the MSK problem, okay? Okay, once again, thank you for us for being part of today's lecture. I'm sorry if there is any mistaken from us. We look forward to seeing you again at our future event. Good afternoon. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Dr. Dini Rahma Erawati, Radiologi Specialist Consultant. And now I will invite Prof. Griffith, Prof. Quek, and Dr. Era to the center of stage to receive a certificate and souvenir from Radiology Specialist Education Program, Faculty of Medicine, Universitas Brawijaya. And I will invite Dr. Indra Sutino Mahayu, Radiologist Consultant, to give souvenir.